Gosh, you look good. So I can actually see you guys and engage with you guys. But again, if you're just joining us with Ron Ricard, Ron, the actual name of the business card you just handed me was IP.
Well, the company's name is Investment Property Exchange Services, for short, IPX 1031.
Okay, IPX 1031. This is yours, right?
This is mine.
Okay, I'll try to steal his water. But we got another, we got some UK people. You were just talking about London a second ago. So let's break it down for dummies first. Let's do this. Ron's done so many podcasts, so many seminars, and I wanted to give this value to you guys. Hey, Melinda, thank you for joining us. So let's start for complete layman's terms for dummies. What the heck is 1031? Why should we care?
Well, the key is it's part of the tax code. It's been part of the tax code for almost 100 years, literally. Okay. And it's something that people use when they want to sell some physical asset. Usually we think of real estate. Yep. And buy replacement investment real estate. And by using 1031 of the tax code, they get to defer paying taxes on the profit that they've made.
Got it.
So you bought a house years ago for $100,000, now it's worth $300,000. If you sell it, you have to pay taxes on $200,000. But because you can do the exchange, you can take that $300,000, go buy other investment real estate with it, and not have to pay the tax on that every time.
Right. And it's tax deferred, but it is taxable.
Eventually.
Yeah. Eventually.
Well,
could you break that down? For us, because that's the goal for today, is to dive into the universe of it and really break it down.
No, that's a good point, because people say, well, if it's only, I'm only deferring the taxes, eventually I have to pay the taxes, so why bother doing an exchange?
True.
There are two reasons I always tell people they want to do the 1031. Number one is, would you prefer to pay your taxes today or tomorrow? Because if I make $200,000 of profit on something and I got to pay $30,000 to the government, I only have $140,000 to reinvest. But because you can do the exchange, you can reinvest the entire $200,000, and that extra $60,000 that you're not giving the government, you get to use that to buy more real estate with it.
Now, the great thing about this is later on, it takes a while for most people to sink in. That's why he's so valuable. But guess what? We're on video. You can pause. You can rewind. You can triple check on exactly what he says until it sinks, because I know it was a difficult concept for me to try to understand, but people fear what they don't know, right? But when you do begin to understand it and stay on top of it, you start to realize how brilliant, how wonderful it is. So rules, though, everyone says, okay, you can capitalize on this as long as you stay on top of the meticulous rules, and that's where your value comes in. What are some common do's, don'ts? What are these meticulous rules that you can't find from a Google search? Some of you guys might be doing right now.
Well, there are really only three major rules that people need to know about. You know, the question is always, what can I buy? How long do I have? How much do I need to spend? And so let's start to dig those one at a time.
Mm-hmm.
There's a term that people that is frequently misunderstood called like-kind, which is sell, which I have to be like-kind.
Mm-hmm.
Well, any kind of investment real estate is like-kind with any other kind of investment real estate. You can sell a rental house and buy a shopping center. You can sell a farm and buy a fourplex. You can sell bare land and buy a rental condo. As long as it's property used for either business or investment, it can be exchanged for any other kind of asset, use for business or investment anywhere in the United States.
That's the definition of like-kind.
Right, yeah. Because most people don't realize we do exchanges on other things. I'm doing an exchange right now on a company who's selling their corporate jet. They're selling an airplane, buying an airplane.
Mm-hmm.
Sell a boat, buy a boat. Sell a cow, buy a cow. I mean, I've done all those.
Right.
And sell artworks, buy artwork. Now, in what's happening with the proposed tax reform in Congress, some of those personal property exchanges may go away, but not real estate. So don't get too worried about the whole term of like-kind.
Right. And so, again, like-kind does not mean exact.
Right.
That's probably a
misconception. Does not have to be a house for house or a commercial for commercial. No, it could be commercial to residential to agricultural, no problem.
So the other two, we just broke down that aspect back to rules, the exact rules. So we got like kind of.
What can I buy?
Second
one is how much or how long do I have?
How long do I have?
And probably the most important numbers to remember here are 45 and 180. 45 days to identify what you're going to buy, 180 days to close escrow. Both those clocks start the day escrow closes on the sale of your property. So that now...
This is where things got tricky for me.
Yeah. So the 45 days is a critical one. You need to know what you're going to buy within 45 days, though you have almost 6 months, 180 days, to close escrow, but you have to close escrow on what you've identified during the 45 days. And so that was,
who are we identifying this? Who are we reporting it to? And of course, IRS.gov, right? They should check out that section to kind of get a better understanding of 1031.
The IRS
is very vague.
The IRS has some good rule, but you know it's a lot of legalese. I mean, our website has a lot of fantastic material as well.
Where can we check that out?
What is it? IPX1031.com. Cool. And we're a national company, have a lot of attorneys on staff, write a lot of good information that is always available there. So again, especially in a market like today where a lot of areas are experiencing a lack of inventory, not a lot of properties on the market, you know, you need to know what you're going to buy within those first 45 days. Now you can identify more than you're going to buy, but for the most part, you want to be in contract for what you want to buy during those 45 days.
Okay, so Joe Schmo has identified what he wants to buy. Joe Schmo already has something, right?
Mm-hmm.
He's doing this even
right.
Exchange for. He can do that on day one, not have to wait for day
right.
45.
Right.
He knows exactly. Okay.
Yeah. I just literally on my way up here today, I was talking to, I set up an exchange where they're closing escrow on the one they're selling on Thursday. They're buying the replacement on Friday. You can be in contract whenever you want. What's important is when you actually close escrow.
Okay. Now, where does valuation play into this? How exactly is
right.
this?
So the next question, how much do you need to spend?
There you go.
Awesome. I should have written notes for you.
Not his question idea. I think I written notes for him. That probably made him laugh. But please.
The answer is simple. All of it.
Okay.
It's not just the equity or not just the profit. It's everything. If you sell a property for $500,000, then you need to buy at least $500,000 worth of replacement property if you want to defer all of your taxes. Mm-hmm. You can go up as much as you want. You can sell for $500,000, buy for $5 million. If you buy down, you pay tax on the difference.
Mm-hmm.
So if you sell for $500,000, you buy something for $450,000, you pay tax on $50,000. But as a rule, you don't want to pay taxes. You want to buy equal or greater to what you're selling the property for.
Equal or greater.
Yeah.
That was another question as well. So if we're buying up, making a $5 million purchase, we can use this to essentially cut that $500,000 from the original one that we're using?
You're taking your basis from this property, reusing that as kind of the basis for the new property. So the profit that you're deferring from this one becomes profit in the next one. Again, it doesn't matter whether it's $1 million or $5 million or 400,
mm-hmm.
you're just deferring the profit into that new property.
So that takes me to the next question. Now, you just said if you're buying down, then there's going to be some sort of penalties. That was a big concern of some questions I gathered from random people. What are tax penalties? When do they occur? Obviously, you just mentioned the majority of them, I guess you shouldn't call them penalties, but they will happen when you are buying. And
right.
Could you give me an example
yeah.
of that for somebody who might be confused?
Yeah, the key is you're paying the taxes. It's not a penalty per
right,
se.
Right.
For the most part, you're paying what's called depreciation recapture tax and capital gain tax.
Okay.
Now, in addition, if you're in a state like California where we have state taxes, then there's also obviously the state tax. But you know, on the federal side, between the capital gains and depreciation recapture, you're looking at, under current tax rules, between 15 and 25%.
Got it.
And then on top of that, you have the anywhere from 4 to 10% for the state taxes as well, depending on what state you're in.
Right.
But so as a rule, it's still a lot of money you're paying in taxes, but you're paying on that delta.
Right, right. Shout out to one of my uncles. He's excited for this one. I told him to send me some questions, and I was just like, whoa, he sent me probably the most complex questions to know that he's probably used this before. He had an example of buying out someone in a partnership. He said, I sold one that I got with somebody else's partnership. Then I sold that one. I already did a 1030 exchange with that one previously.
Mm-hmm.
Can I buy my partnership share with that money exchange?
Well, so actually, partnerships are a huge issue because you cannot exchange an interest in a partnership.
Okay.
So if you're selling a property that's in a partnership, the partnership itself can do the exchange.
Okay.
But you can't have somebody sell their share. So if you and I own a piece of property together in a partnership,
right?
We can't sell the property and you go buy something, I go buy something else.
Mm-hmm.
Because the taxpayer who owns that property is the partnership.
Mm-hmm.
That's who has to do the exchange.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in your uncle's question, if his question is, can I sell something on my own
mm-hmm.
and buy my partners out of a partnership so that at the end I own the entire property in my name? The answer is actually yes.
Okay.
Now, obviously, I'd love to know more of the details, but
yeah.
there's often a way to do that.
Interesting. Interesting. And so it would get complex on exactly how to do that. Mm-hmm. Was this one that they just sold on top of that was previously used to get that with a 1031
exchange? That's fine. That's fine. Okay. You can exchange, you know, throughout your life. As a matter of fact, the motto of our industry is swap till you drop. Okay, mm-hmm. You just keep exchanging, and then when you pass away, the other good thing is when you pass away under current tax rules, your heirs get to step up in tax basis, and all the capital gains that you would have paid when you were alive, your heirs don't have to.
Well, this is going to make everyone's head spin. He sent another cool one that I had to kind of translate, digest, so bear with me here. Mm-hmm. He said, I opened 1031, I bought two different properties that I use with that money, and now both of those properties, I'm selling them. Can I buy? I'm selling both of those properties again. Can I buy one property that is equivalent to the amount, the same amount of money? I guess he's assuming of those two properties.
Right. Interesting. Buying and selling multiple properties is perfectly fine. Selling one to buy multiple properties. Selling multiple properties to buy one.
Oh, there's a limit. Is there a limit?
No.
Okay.
Let's just wait. If you look at identification limits, people think there's a limit. The reality is, with enough planning, you can do pretty much whatever you want. I had a client once buy 18 houses, sold one property, bought 18 houses as a replacement.
Equivalent to those.
Exactly. The 18 houses.
This one was probably in the Bay. That one was probably Detroit.
Las Vegas.
Las Vegas.
Palo Alto to Las Vegas.
Palo Alto to Las Vegas. Okay.
But Daniel, there is a way to do it. The only key there, if he's selling the two properties to buy one replacement, is that 45-day clock starts when the first one closes escrow. So you do want to sell the two relatively close together so that you know you have the money to go buy whatever you're going to go buy.
Okay. So did he have to identify those 18 within the 45 days, or like you said, just one?
Oh, wow. No. She actually identified 30 houses and bought 18 of them.
So you had to get the clock was ticking.
Right. But this is different market. It was when the real estate market was down. Lots of inventory wasn't a problem. Today,
a lot more yeses, a lot less complication.
Today, that'd be virtually impossible to do.
Because of how competitive the buyers are? Okay. Yeah. Just to switch gears from what you've been seeing, are you seeing the same? Because we all know commercial is a bit of the wild, wild west. I grew up in that. And then we have the home market. What variations are you seeing? Are you seeing similar to the home market where it's kind of seller's paradise and buyer's nightmare where it's very competitive, more demand? What are you seeing in those two realms?
I mean, there's no question it's a seller's market right now.
Yep.
And, you know, I have a lot of clients who would like to do exchanges, but they're definitely afraid of that 45-day clock and finding a property within that time frame that's going to make sense for them, that they're not overbidding on or just going kind of crazy.
Right.
So, yeah, it is an issue. It all depends on where the market is. You know, everyone I talk to thinks they have horrible inventory. But some places truly are much worse than others. And the key here is not to wait. As soon as you got your property locked up in terms of a buyer for your property, get out there, start looking, narrow down what you want. And I would say close to 90% of our clients successfully complete their exchange. They find the property they want to buy.
Right. What are some of the biggest common stigmas? Not stigmas, I would say, or common misconceptions people have about 1031. The first thing they see is like, well, this has got to do with tax. Turn the page over. I don't want to deal with it. Just for anybody who's joining, who's even heard the concept for the first time, what are some of the, that's kind of a tougher question, what are the common misconceptions that you see or get asked that make you smile right off the bat?
Well, there are a bunch of them. But, you know, for example, a lot of people think they only have to reinvest their profit or just have to reinvest their equity. When they learn they have to reinvest everything, that gives people pause. So that's one issue. The other issue is the whole like kind. What is investment real estate? Just before we got on, I was talking to a woman who has a property that's been her second home, and she wanted to do an exchange. And I explained, no, you can't. You can't exchange a second home. That's not investment real estate. Same thing with primary residences, like here in the Bay Area.
Whoa. Why was it? It was a second home. Why did it not qualify? Because it was owner occupied?
No.
Because the
property is for personal use.
Got it.
It's
got to be designated.
It has to be a property that's either you're running a business from it, or more likely, it's a property you're getting rental income from.
And what does that mean to people? Is this establishment of a corporation, its name, escort, or what qualifies it for those who don't know as an investment or rental property?
The key is, what are you showing in your tax return?
Got it.
If on your tax return you're showing rental income, it doesn't need to be in any kind of entity. It's just you on your personal tax return. You have a rental house. It's probably showing on what's called your Schedule E. And you're telling the IRS today, I own investment real estate, and therefore, that is what I'm doing the exchange on.
And that's happened for at least one tax year, and you've informed your CPA about something like that to make sure that's done clearly.
Most accounts recommend a couple of years, but yes.
Okay.
But that essentially, you know, it always boils down to what he's showing on your tax return.
I think that was an important one, yeah.
Yeah, and if on your tax return, you're saying, well, it's a second home, it's on my Schedule A, well, it's not an investment property. If you're saying, I'm getting rental income, and here are my expenses, it's on Schedule E.
Yep.
It's investment real estate. So there is a it all goes back down to what he tell the IRS.
Right. And that is the best way to be able to make use for a program like that, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So let's see. What was the third aspect? The third that we broke down. We broke down the time, and the last aspect you said was usually the most common question. Do we touch upon that?
The dollars. Yeah,
the dollars,
and which equal or greater in value. So yeah, we did talk about that.
So what are some common things that people should look at? How you doing, Anish? What are some common people that people should look out for to ensure a smooth transition? What have you seen? Obviously, call this man. But what are some common hiccups that people really out there can get some value from that they should try to avoid and be on top of, if any, you would say?
The first thing is plan ahead of time. Mm. I frequently will give somebody who decides to do an exchange, you know, a day before escrow closes, and they're behind the eight ball. They in terms of finding replacement property, in terms of what the rules are. So the first thing is plan ahead of time. You know, what do you want to buy? How much do you want to spend? What markets do you want to get into? So that when you are, you know, have your property in contract or on the market, at least now you know what you're looking for. So planning, I think, especially in a market like today, is probably the most critical.
Probably everything.
Thing.
Timeline.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So I've been told by some people that never get into a deal that has a timeline, unless you're very prepared, and that's ahead. And we're talking contract to contract, Wild West. You shouldn't accept a deal from somebody else that, you know, ensures a timeline, because things don't always work out that way, especially with, you know, city government entities that were doing a specific project. I guess that doesn't really, you know, play as much, because once you purchase a property, you can go through that process kind of after. What if they don't hit the timeline of, say, 180 days or 45 days? So obviously they have 45 days and they have 180 days to close. What exactly can they see there? What is that?
They just get their money back and pay the taxes. There's no penalty for failing the exchange,
okay,
other than our initial fee of $850. There's no error in trying, is what I always put. If you aren't sure if you're going to find a property in 45 days, try. Put the money into the exchange, and if you find something during the 45 days, fantastic. If you don't, you get your money back, and you have the exact same tax consequence you would have had you not sold the property.
And that consequence is?
You pay those taxes.
You pay
taxes on whatever the gain, you know, whatever the capital gain is on that property, whatever the depreciation is on the property. You just pay whatever the taxes are that you would have paid had you not started the exchange. One thing I should point out here to remember is, whenever you do an exchange, the IRS does require the use of a neutral third party called the intermediary. That's what we do.
Okay.
So you can't just sell your property and say, oh, I'm doing an exchange. You have to have the exchange set up so that at the close of escrow, the escrow officer or closing attorney or settlement agent, whoever's handling that escrow, it knows it's an exchange and knows what to do with the funds, because if the client touches the money, if the seller gets the money, they pay taxes. You can't do an exchange at that point.
I love it. We talked a little bit about this before already. How many properties can be identified in a 1031 exchange? My assumption is, I read some places six, I read some places three, but from what we just learned from Ron, it is relative.
Well, there are three rules, one of which is never used.
Okay.
The first rule is three properties. You can identify three properties, any value whatsoever. So for most people, if you're going to go sell one, buy one, they can identify up to three. Again, you have to buy from that list.
Mm-hmm.
But if your goal is to sell one and buy more than three, there's a second way to identify that allows you to identify a dollar maximum. And a dollar maximum is two times what you sold. It's called the 200% rule. So if you sell a $500,000 property, you can identify $1 million worth of property.
Interesting.
But again, three properties or fewer, no dollar limit. More than three, now we have a dollar limit.
I see where that's the only one that I was avoiding. He wanted to skip of uncles. He was going on about 1 million has to be over 500,000. 500,000, does that purchase have to be over a million, same, under, or higher? That might be equivalent to what exactly?
I missed the question.
He's talking about. So a million. So this was trying to digest him, typing right. quickly, and figure out what he was saying. But the example that you just gave me with three property rule, it was equivalent to. Could you repeat it one more time for those yep. who may not?
Three properties, or if you identify three properties or fewer, there's no dollar limit. So if you sell $1 million property, you can identify $100 million properties. If you identify more than three. Now you're capped at a dollar maximum of the values of those properties. So the total value of everything you identify cannot exceed two times what you sold.
Okay. So Palo Alto, Las Vegas lady, we gave this example before. Where do appraisers come in and how do they play into this? Before we make this exchange, we identify the property. People always talk about, you know, the controversy of fair market value, comparative analysis. Is there a different process that goes through for this Palo Alto home that she bought 18 Vegas properties with? How does one assess that?
Well, the key is this, is that you're saying, what is the value of the property? So, for example, let's say the property in Las Vegas was worth $100,000. Mm-hmm. And she writes $100,000 on the piece of paper. The reality, is it worth $100,000? Who knows?
Exactly.
I mean, so there is kind of a gray area in terms of how the IRS will look at it.
Right.
As a rule, though, most people will just use whatever the selling price of the property is. Mm. I mean, that's the most common, the most easy to justify.
Right. Because that would be a concern to me if I was Palo Alto, lady. I'm trying to figure out the value of my home as well. We have tax assessor's value.
But you've already sold your property. Remember?
Okay, got it.
This is only on the replacement properties.
Got it.
So she sold her property.
God, so you know what that's equivalent to?
Right, exactly.
Okay.
And then two times that, that's your dollar limit, and then you're going forward into
the negotiations of those offers, and then that's going to be upon you two to figure out what that is worth exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Amazing. What are some other questions you could think of to really give value to these people while we have you? You've been giving some seminars as well. Do you do those often? Are those often in the Bay Area somebody can check out?
I do a lot of seminars at the realtor associations throughout the Bay Area, as well as real estate offices. Sometimes agents will ask me to come and give seminars to their clients. We also have two webinars we do every month that are attorney runs that you can go to our website and sign up for.
Mm-hmm.
So there's always a lot of good information out there. When it comes to what people are, what questions people have, they're always very personal questions. This is what I'm doing.
Mm-hmm.
And we can get into, the basic rules of the 1031.
Right.
But the reality is, how does it affect me? And so what I always recommend is when you're ready to do it, call an intermediary.
They are very, very situational.
Yeah, exactly.
Although we explain the basis of the rules, your situation might be a lot
you're like different. like your uncle with that partnership. That's a great question, and it's one that we need to make sure we're structuring it properly. Sometimes we'll have situations. A good example in today's market is we have a lot of people who have their primary residence, whose primary residence, the gain on that property is way more than the $250,000 or $500,000 that they're allowed to keep tax free when they sell it.
Mm-hmm.
Here you may have somebody who bought a house for $400,000, now it's worth $2 million. I'm sure you see that a great deal as an agent.
Yep.
These people feel that they're stuck. They have a primary residence. Gain is way more, so they're looking at a very large tax hit. Well, let's plan for these people.
Mm-hmm.
Turn your property to a rental. Rent it for a couple of years.
Right.
Now you've been renting it for a couple of years, it's a rental. But guess what? The best news is it still qualifies as a primary residence also.
Mm-hmm.
So they sell it for the $2 million, pocket the $500,000 exclusion, assuming they're married, and they do an exchange on the remaining $1.5 million. Again, with a little bit of planning and within a couple of years, they may have saved themselves $300,000 or $400,000 in taxes.
Wow, brilliant. That already answers my next question. Let's see. We drew a T-chart, overall pros, overall cons. We're trying to make what would you pick as the number one pro from this? And it'll be essentially exactly what you just explained, I think, seconds prior. The pros can be in pocketing that tax deferred, essentially capital gains,
right?
Capital gains on sale of the property. So I was looking at the rules of 1031 exchange, a like exchange or a starker? what's the word Starker mean exactly? That's just a fancy term for something?
No, what happened was, believe it or not, 1031s used to have to be done simultaneously. You have to buy and sell on the same day. Mm-hmm. And if you didn't buy and sell on the same day, exactly. As a matter of fact, there's an escrow officer here in Milpitas. She's retired now, but she once did an exchange where they recorded 68 consecutive deeds. Mm-hmm. Because 68 properties were exchanged at one time.
Wow.
But what happened was, back in the 70s, there was a court case where a gentleman by the name of Starker challenged whether it had to be done simultaneously.
Interesting.
And he won.
Right.
And so what happened was, we now were able to sell today and not buy until next week, next month, whatever. And in doing that, a lot of people started calling them Starker exchanges after this court decision. Now, the reality is that was 40 years ago. Nobody does that anymore. but...
because imagine the 68 deeds.
Yeah,
it got a little messy.
But him challenging the IRS, you know, forced the tax code to change. And now, in 1984, they established these 4,580 day limits that we're using. So don't worry about the term Starker exchange. A Starker exchange is exactly a 1031 exchange.
Right. It's beautiful to know that type of history. Sometimes people like that, right? They open the door on so many things, including you going into this. Mm-hmm. Ram, right?
Yeah.
So what I want to touch on a little bit, the number one goal is, you know, it's not about Ron, it's not about me. We want to give value to you guys. It's so cool. We're behind the sounds of the airport watching these planes fly right now. But what got you into this, Ron? What got you? I always love that. I love that.
Let's put it this way. We are probably the world's smallest industry. If you added up everybody who does 1031 exchange.
It's a niche, but I love the niches.
Exactly. But if you added up everybody in the entire country involved in what I do, I know you'd have less than 1,000 people, and my boss swears you'd have less than 500.
Hey, so, but to the kids out there, I used to think backwards. I'll get a business marketing degree. That way, I have a scope of everything I can do.
Yeah.
But it's so important that the more specific, the more specialized you are on a particular subject, the more value you're going to have, right, through this. So that's very cool. I'll throw some twisters at you. I'm a big quote nerd, but in the terms of this, one quote jumps out at you off the top of your head that you feel you live by, that you feel is important to you. I know that could be a tough
one. With regard to exchanges or
sure,
just in general?
Sure.
Well, in exchanges, the quote, in fact, I have a t-shirt that says, you know, swap till you drop. You just keep exchanging and hopefully never have to worry about paying the taxes ever. That's the quote of our industry.
So if anybody's considering, you know, whether they should buy, whether they should sell, they should obviously, they're going to be doing that anyways. They should be considering swapping.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. And you know, there's, you at the beginning or a few minutes ago, you were talking about what are the negatives about 1031. And the reality is, there is one negative, is that you're still investing in real estate.
Mm-hmm.
I know a lot of people who, after owning their rental property for a few years or a few decades,
mm-hmm.
are just sick of dealing with tenants. And they're looking for an exit strategy because they are tired of having to work with investment real estate. There are solutions for those people also, whether it's commercial real estate or fractional ownership or seller financing. There are solutions for people if they're looking to get out of real estate. But that's the ultimate problem people have sometimes is, I don't want to have rental properties anymore. How do I get out?
So I think that was super valuable. And I think one of the biggest key takeaways off my mind is that people could be renting out properties now, but they simply have not structured it in a way with their CPA to be able to qualify for a program like this. So that would be their next to do, and let it pass at least a few years, right? It's obviously going to be better. Schedule E is what you mentioned for that. But back to this gentleman. My next question is going to be, if you could have a gigantic billboard sign, Ron, what would it say? I already know the answer. Swap till you drop and call Ron, right? Unless you beg to differ.
No, that's okay. Fine. I would take that.
All right. We get in a time machine. Ron can say anything to his 30-year-old self. He gets to whisper something. What advice would you give to yourself?
This is not 1031, obviously.
Study 1031
actually,
more, Ron.
No, I mean, actually, I will say, if I'd gotten this job 10 years sooner, it would be even better. If I went back, I don't know about going back to my 30s, but going back to probably when I was in college, it'd be take more risks.
Mm.
You know, life is short. If you play it too safe, you may make a good living out of it, but you know, there are too many opportunities out there. Take some risks, and if you don't fail a few times,
mm-hmm.
then you probably haven't taken all the risks you need to.
And some would argue doing the safest thing is actually the riskiest thing you can do. right?
Yeah.
That they're trying to play the safe route or use the predictable business that has always worked or those type of things can sometimes be risky in their own sense to not evolve with the times, mm-hmm. not evolve with the market,
sure.
And always go that route. I love it. One that I always ask my guests that I love is, what was an apparent failure in your life, or what you thought at the time during then was a failure, but later turned out to be the biggest blessing in disguise looking back and segmented you through a whole different way down the road? What would that be for you?
It's when I joined a software company. I have a degree in marketing, and so I was actually nice. Marketing director for a software company. Absolutely hated the job.
So did I.
And thank God they fired me. and when they fired me, a week later I had this job,
right.
and so it's what got me into this job is completely failing at the job I had before.
I guarantee for anybody out there, those first 3 days that passed after you did get fired, mm-hmm. you probably had that sick feeling in your stomach, or you thought it was the end of the world, and you thought nothing was gonna find your way, and then boom, time is a beautiful thing, right?
Yep, absolutely.
And we look at 1031 exchange and look at all the variables, the most common variable in your favor or not in your favor, the way you look at it, it's time, right? Time is the variable on something like that. What's new, Ron, in past few, you would say 2015 and 2017, in the world of 1031 exchange for those who try to stay on top of it? Any new tweaks or changes there?
It's interesting because I know that whenever I give a seminar, especially to someone like real estate agents, we're supposed to know to some degree. They always say, "Well, things are different now than they ever have been." Yeah. The answer is no, they haven't.
Pretty much the same.
Rules have been the same since 1991 when the IRS came out with a procedure on how to interpret what Congress put out. Hasn't been. I mean, I think
what was that?
In 1984 is when Congress changed the law and made 1031s available. You know, had to put in that 45 days, 180 days. Also started the whole intermediary that you can touch the money.
So and that wasn't Starker, though? Starker was further back?
Starker was the court decision that threw out kind of how the IRS was viewing 1031.
Got it.
And then Congress said, okay, this is kind of the Wild West now. Let's put some real rules on it.
Mm.
And they put the rules together. And then in 5 or 7 years later, the IRS interpreted the tax code to do what we do today, that you have to use the intermediary, that you know you have to buy what you've identified in the 45 days, those kinds of things. So it all came
They brought out. In the third party,
right.
And then is that where Schedule E was established too?
No, Schedule E, that's always been a tax thing.
That's
something on the tax code.
Very complicated issue, and that's why it's so important. We already heard once CPAs were into this game. I've had a CPA on, and that's why it's so important to have a tax professional.
Oh,
because we're humble enough to say, okay, Ron's like, I'm 1031 exchange expert. When it comes to taxes, we got to be humble enough to say, check your tax professional. He knows more than me. Those people who think they know it all, try to do everything themselves, that's where you're going to run into some problems, right? You got to be humble enough to bring in a consultant, bring in someone else who has just been living this subject more than you. The book you've given the most as a gift, or one that you tell your buddies like, oh, you got to read this.
Actually, it's funny because I'm not a huge reader, but one thing I love to do, especially for kids, I love giving kids atlases.
Okay.
Because you know, we all tend to look at the world, what we see in front of us, and not enough people travel, and not enough people have the opportunity to travel. But guess what? You give a kid a book, an atlas, you know, they can see the world. And I love sharing that. And
you realize how small we really are.
Oh God, yes.
Aside from
yes.
your hometown,
yep.
right? And I think that's the biggest blessing is whenever we start to get too spoiled, Dad would immediately take us to India, and then we come back kissing the ground on exactly what we have and how we have it. So any obsessions besides 1031 that you like to explore at your free time? Golf?
No, I'm not a golfer, but I'm a pretty big wine guy. I actually work at a winery on weekends occasionally.
Nice.
And love going to Napa Sonoma. And
what's the word? Connoisseur? When you deeply dived into something.
Yeah,
besides.
I don't have the palate to be a real connoisseur, but I just enjoy it. And it's a fun lifestyle. And especially when you get to work and talk to people and pour wine, people love it. It's fun.
I love that. There's nothing better than getting a bus too and doing these little wine tours.
Yep.
And I always get made fun of by my buddies because they're always like, Scotch on the rock. Look, Terry just jumped on. Hey, Terry. But I always loved the Moscatos. They call me a big girl. All the sweet wines, all the ports, all the hard to find. You know, I think for some people, they're going to have to pause, rewind the first half. But I'm impressed. Sir. We really hit and jumped on every single topic there. I guess the last thing is one more time. You probably answered it already. You can identify whatever is equivalent to your properties in exchange. As many as you like, 3, 6. Obviously, you gave me the example of Palo Alto. She went 1 to 18. Sure. As long as that they're equivalent, there are no real caps. Well, how about this? Internationally, any rules affected? This is domestic only?
This is U.S. only. A year, you know, 30 plus years ago, you could actually exchange internationally, but not anymore. Now it has to be U.S. to U.S. Now, technically, you can exchange foreign real estate for foreign real estate. But much, much more complicated. Definitely not worth doing it for
us. So you're a U.S. resident. You're exchanging foreign to foreign.
Yes.
Obviously, you'd have to be a U.S. resident. And then there's going to be a whole other universe of teacher. Because it depends on what exact country is X in versus X, right?
And as intermediary, we hardly ever see foreign to foreign exchanges. Very complicated. We tend to avoid them whenever possible. But
that's the right thing to do. You've got to be humble.
Legally, they do exist.
Right, right. Amazing. I think we harped on everything. As far as any other frequently asked questions, do you feel that we've missed that you might want to add on, any that you can think of off the top of your head that's really been coming to you a lot? I mean, essentially, it is make sure it's structured correctly, make sure it's Schedule E, and then it's ready to go. Does the other property have to also be in that format?
Remember, yeah, because that's a good point. What you sell and what you buy both have to be investment real estate.
Okay, got it. How does one identify that the 18 in Vegas were?
Because
timeshares,
because when, you know, before she had her Schedule E, says I have this one rental property in Palo Alto, mm-hmm. and her next year's tax return said I now have 18 rental properties in each of Vegas Schedule E with her, and so they show the rental income from all of them.
So those 18 that she purchased were already had been identified as Schedule E as well.
Well, no, she started doing it that way. Whether they were rentals before she bought them, who cares? Okay. She bought them as rental. She bought them as rentals, and therefore they were used. Mm-hmm. As rental property, mm-hmm. she gets there for us to declare the income on her taxes and that kind of stuff. So it doesn't matter what the property was before, as long as you're using it as an investment property and you're reflecting it that way when you file your taxes.
That's probably one of the biggest questions you get is like, well, Ron, is this like-minded? What do you think? I want to get this. Remember the commercial debt you said?
Yeah.
If it's something that's completely different, for example, that Uncle talked about, he used 1031 exchange and just closed on his property of pistachios, mm-hmm. just got a whole bunch of money. Obviously, would he? So now we know that he wouldn't just have to buy another almond farm. He can actually get.
You can buy rental houses. You can buy farm buildings. And one of the things, I do a lot of exchanges out in the Central Valley where you're retiring farmers, where they have the pistachio orchards, the almond orchards, the walnut orchards, the mm-hmm. vineyards. Mm-hmm. You know, they sell a property for $2 million. They want to retire. What are you going to do with that money? Well, it's probably a good idea to buy something that's going to generate income for you. Buy a bunch of rental houses. Buy
that's apartment. Exact buildings, situation he's in right now.
Yeah, yep. Very, very common thing to do. It seems like in the Central Valley, a lot of people like to buy vacation rentals on the coast or in the mountains also. But it's a good plan to, you know, continue to make money, basically.
For the empty nesters, yeah, because you want to retire, but at the same time, lump sums aren't as friendly as having this predictable income, right? And if they ever need another loan, I'm sure banks also like to see that predictable monthly streams of income versus having lump sums in your account. Mm-hmm. I'm sure you can be assessed.
How much does the bank pay in interest these days?
Right.
Not too much.
We could do a whole talk on that. We're at 45. I love it, Ron. This was a pleasure. Loads of value here. I'm going to be like pausing, rewinding, trying to learn as much as this gentleman knows. But again, if we want to reach you, where can we reach you, Ron? What do you recommend?
What I recommend, our website's ipx1031.com. That's I like Indian, P like Peter, X like X-ray. My phone number, I got a toll-free number, 877-747-7875. Again, 877-747-7875. Feel free to call. I'm always available.
Yep, and I'll throw in a link in the description and ticker symbol, but just wanted to thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you guys for joining us. Happy holidays to all you guys. Congratulations to soon-to-be grandpa.
Yep.
As having one on the way just in time for Christmas. But I hope that brought you guys some value. And you'll know as soon as I throw in the description how to reach Ron. So thank you guys so much for joining. And we hope this brings you value. This is exactly what this is all about. I'm Roman Nahal. Ron Ricard.
Yes.
Ricard. Cheers. Take care, guys. Amazing. Loved it.
Love it.
Thanks so much.